Next item of business on the order paper is the motion on the reclassification of housing associations. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for the debate. An amendment has been selected and is published on the marshal list. The amendment has been tabled by the proposers of the motion. The motion and the amendment will be proposed together and wound together with 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
That this assembly notes the likelihood that the Office for National Statistics will reclassify Northern Ireland's 22 housing associations from independent social businesses to public bodies, that this may limit their ability to access private finance to build new homes, that the £1 billion worth of private debt already on their books could be added to the executive's balance sheet, taking the executive's total borrowing to levels which would reduce drastically its ability to borrow money for other initiatives across the executive departments, and calls on the Minister for Communities to prepare to bring forward urgent legislation to reverse the reclassification of Northern Ireland housing associations so that they can remain classified as independent social businesses.
Thank you. I call Mr. Andy Allen to move the motion and the amendment. Mr. Allen.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I beg to move both the motion and the amendment. Mr. Speaker, as members will be aware, since the motion was originally tabled, events have moved on somewhat, and so an amendment was necessary to take account of changed circumstances. The original motion was tabled in advance of the decision by ONS to reclassify Northern Ireland's housing associations as public bodies, which was announced on Thursday, the 29th of September. What on face of it might appear to be a relatively unimportant and technical change in accounting rules would actually have a very serious implications indeed. This is a problem which needs to be rectified quickly, and we will give our help and support to the Executive within reason to help with the solution. We welcome the fact that the Executive has vowed to seek a reversal of ONS' decision to reclassify NI housing associations, including amending legislation where appropriate. Mr. Speaker, our motion and our amendment were tabled because we had two main areas of concern. The first was the housing associations could find it difficult to raise funding, and as a result, there would be a serious effect on their ability to build badly needed social housing. Given that we are already in the midst of a housing crisis, anything which might contribute to uncertainty and jeopardise the social housing building programme should be avoided at all costs. In the next 4 years, approximately 8,000 social starts are planned, and these would obviously be under threat if there was any question over whether or not local housing associations were able to continue to borrow in the same manner as they can at present and raise much-needed private finances. There would also be a major implications for the co-ownership scheme, affecting roughly 700 to 800 homes each year. This scheme is funded via the financial transactions capital money from the Treasury, and one of the primary conditions is that it can only be lent to private bodies. The second concern was that as a result of this reclassification, the approximately £1 billion worth of borrowing currently on local housing associations' books would be transferred onto the Executive's balance sheet. This would obviously have a potentially devastating effect on the Executive's finances. As I stated earlier, our original motion was tabled prior to both the ONS announcement that Northern Ireland Housing Associations would be reclassified as public bodies and the statement by both the Ministers for Communities and Finance. As a result of this, my party, working with our opposition colleagues, the SDLP, have brought forward the amendment. The amendment takes account of the changed circumstances, and we are confident that we'll command support across the House. The ONS did not just pronounce on the reclassification of Northern Ireland Housing Associations as public bodies, they also reclassified their counterparts in Scotland and Wales. We are of the view that as Northern Ireland, Scotland and Wales have all been set exactly the same challenge at exactly the same time, if the Executive is serious about being focused on delivery, then we need to act at least as swiftly as the Scottish and the Welsh. Stormont has often been accused of being inert and being slow to act. This simply cannot be allowed to happen here. Given that ONS said we will assess the impact of these classification decisions and will update the affected statistics at the earliest opportunity, we have concerns as to what the implications might be for Northern Ireland should there be any delay. We need to see a coordinated approach taken by the Minister for Communities and Finance, to the very real dangers that we face. We need to get an appropriate derogation agreed with the Treasury, and then we need to ensure that the derogation is of sufficient length of time. The legislative process in this House can seem rather torturous, and it should go without saying that we need to ensure that we get the relevant legislation through this House without delay, and certainly well within the time frame of the derogation. Even if legislation was being drafted today, we could be facing a very tight timetable in terms of the Treasury derogation. Given that it can take 18 to 24 months for legislation to pass through this House, all the required stages receive full scrutiny, and that we want to see a joined up concerted action between the devolved administrations in Northern Ireland, Scotland and Wales, if we could agree a joint endeavour between the three devolved administrations on this matter in dealing with the Treasury with regard to derogation and getting a deal on the interim arrangements. In short, we need an appropriate derogation with a realistic time frame. We therefore need a commitment from the Ministers for Communities and Finance that when we get the legislation through this House, not just in a timely manner, but at least as quickly as the administrations in Edinburgh and Cardiff. This is a very important point because just as ONS have ruled on housing associations in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland at the same time, it is more than logical to assume that when they come to reconsider their status at the same time, and as stated earlier, they will assess the impact of these classification decisions and will update the effect of statistics at the earliest opportunity. There's a real danger that Northern Ireland could get left behind and the derogation could run out, and this is something that we want to avoid at all costs, given the serious difficulties it would cause in terms of housing associations' ability to deliver new build housing and borrowing ability of the executive. In conclusion, Mr. Speaker, given that the most recent figures of June 2016, there are 37,347 households on the housing waiting list, 22,986 of which were deemed to be in housing stress, and 15,747 were deemed to be in statutorily homeless, it is imperative we act swiftly. Therefore, I would call on either the Minister for Communities or Finance to set out a clear timeline as to what action they intend to take. The Opposition is ready and willing to work with the relevant executive ministers for the benefit of Northern Ireland. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Call Mr. Christopher Stalford.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, as someone who represents South Belfast, I am painfully aware of the shortages that there are in social housing. I think all members who represent Belfast constituencies, but not only Belfast, of course, beyond that, have found that there is a need for more social housing. The last executive met its target with regard to social housing, and this one has set an ambitious target of 8,000, as has been mentioned by Mr. Allen, the Member for East Belfast. I think that members can be assured of the commitment of the Government to achieving a reversal in the Office of National Statistics decision, not only through the various statements that there have been by the Minister in relation to this issue, but also by the various statements that there have been by the Minister for Finance as well. The Minister of Finance and the Minister of Communities took this issue to the Northern Ireland Executive on the very afternoon that the decision was announced in order to secure the agreement of the Executive to address this issue. There is a recognition in the heart of government of the need to secure that derogation, and it has been evidenced by both my colleague, the Minister for Communities, and also by the Minister for Finance. Officials in the Department for Communities and the Department for Finance are working together to achieve an effective derogation that will allow the time that is needed for all of the actions to ensure a successful reversal of the Office of National Statistics decision. It is important in this debate to note, Mr. Speaker, that ministers in a devolved government have no control over the Office of National Statistics. The ONS is the United Kingdom's largest independent producer of official statistics. It is the recognised national statistical institution for the United Kingdom. Its responsibilities, as members will know, include collecting and publishing statistics related to the economy, population and society at national, regional and local levels. The Office of National Statistics independently determines classification decisions, strictly in accordance with agreed rules set out in established systems. It is important that we remember that when we are approaching this issue. The Northern Ireland Executive is committed to delivering on its housing target, and we're committed to dealing with the issues that have been raised here. The one thing that I would say, reading the wording of the motion that's been tabled before the House in relation to these matters, is I welcome the fact that it has been acknowledged. The Executive is actually doing what's being called for in this motion. The content of this motion calls for actions that are already being undertaken by the Executive. In an ordinary system, in a more parliamentary system perhaps, it's supposed to be the opposition that leads the government, but in this instance it's the government that's leading the opposition. Because if you read the content of what's presented to the House today, it's calling on the government to undertake actions that are already being undertaken. I don't want to add any further discomfort for our friends at the bottom of the chamber, but it might be worth perhaps considering more detailed discussions with ministers before rushing in motions demanding actions that are already being carried out by those in positions.
I thank the member for giving way, and of course he makes a valid point, because government of course ought to be ahead of the curve on this issue because it was a predictable one. Would you not agree that it might have been an opportunity for the minister to come and make a statement to the House and clarify what exactly he was doing in the interim of the last 11 days so that members could be fully informed?
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you. I thank the lady for her point. There are a few more well informed than her in the House, and I think that she makes her point well. I do think it's important to note, though, that the actions that are being called for are actually being undertaken. One of the issues that has been raised is, of course, the whole issue of the implications that this determination has on public spending and our capacity to borrow money. This has implications that go way beyond simply matters of housing. Obviously, I suspect particularly the universities in my constituency will be looking very closely at the content of the debate and subsequent resolution to the issues that have been raised. I think that we can be confident that the changes that the Department is going to bring forward will allow us to achieve a reversal on the ONS position. There are no certainties, of course, but I believe this is the reason why officials in the Department will be closely examining with the Office of National Statistics, and I believe that we can be sure as anything can be in life, but we can be confident that every effort will be made to ensure that this decision is reversed. And I believe that that's what everyone, government or opposition, wants to see happen. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
We call Mr. Fra McCann.
I raised to speak to the motion in the name of the Ulster Unionists. It was now amended in the name of both the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP. And I have to say, when I first read the motion, it seemed to me that the Ulster Unionists had not only jumped the gun in terms of bringing this motion, which I believe was rushed and out of date, but it was asking for steps to be taken, which both Ministers of Finance and Communities had already been working towards. In fact, I had already raised these issues with both ministers and had been assured that all that could be done was being done in the run-up to the decision of the Office of National Statistics to reclassify housing associations across the North from independent social enterprises to public finance bodies. I believe this amendment is also now redundant, given the decision of the Executive last Thursday, who had approved a joint paper from Ministers O'Mealier and Given to seek a reversal of the ONS decision to reclassify housing associations in the North, including amending legislation where appropriate. They both said that the Executive is committed to providing suitable homes for all, and they will now work together to find the best way forward to allow investment to continue. The Minister for Finance added to this by saying, having secured and stable social housing sector as a cornerstone of our civic society. He went on to say that we need to take all measures necessary to ensure the sector has the ability to invest and grow. The decision of the Office of National Statistics, if left unaddressed by the executive, would have changed the budgeting rules and could have resulted in an annual shortfall of 100 million in relation to social and affordable housing. That is why he said we plan to seek a derogation to prevent this happening. I believe this clearly shows the ministers and the executive who are clued into the difficulties. I believe this clearly shows the ministers and the executive who are clued in to the difficulties the decision ONS made and have been proactive in putting in place the measures which would seek a derogation. It is also my understanding that the Minister of Finance has been in touch with his equivalent in both Scotland and Wales to ensure there is joined up thinking and a solution to reclassification can be found. In a statement by the Chief Executive of NIFA, Cameron Watt, responding to the Office for National Statistics reclassification of housing association, said he warmly welcomed the decision of the executive to seek a reversal of the decision and their commitment to amend legislation if appropriate. He went on to say he was delighted that the executive has acted decisively to seek a reversal of the ONS decision, saying it is vitally important in sustaining the successful partnership. He went on to say, we are grateful to Communities Minister and Finance Minister Marcin O'Muller for their immediate and effective response to the ONS decision. Both ministers have recognised the crucial role of housing associations in delivering much needed home. The decision in October 2015 by the Office of National Statistics to reclassify housing associations in England from private financial corporations to public non-financial corporations sent shockwaves in housing circles across the north, not at least the impact of reclassification on housing associations here. Now that this has happened, it is crucial that we leave nothing to chance. It is important also to build that partnership Cameron Watt speaks of, not only move to obtain derogation, but to plot out a strategy in terms of house building in the social housing sector. And I understand what my colleague across the chamber has said in terms of the commitment for 8,000 houses, but we should take that as a minimum target rather than a maximum target. And this also needs to include developing ways to give the powers back of new build back to the housing executive. The fact that the housing provider is sitting on 88,000 houses in terms of stock and can't use them to lever in much needed finance is madness. Just imagine what a game changer this could be in terms of new build as we work towards a solution to the reclassification. Problems we also need to work to make the changes necessary to bring the housing executive back into play. We need to look at how we bring the thousands of empty homes back into use.
Member, conclude his remarks.
Chair, would just like to mention, because it hasn't been taken up, the significance of today being World Homeless Day and World Mental Health Day, two issues which cross paths and needs our urgent attention.
Member's time is up. Call Ms. Nicola Mallon.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It is not only important, but it is essential that this motion was brought to the House today. It's essential because of the profound financial, economic and societal impact of this reclassification by the Office of National Statistics of Northern Ireland's 22 housing associations from independent social businesses to public bodies. On both housing associations' ability to access finance and build critically and much needed new homes, and its potential of adding up to $1 billion, as this motion points out, of debt to the executive's balance sheet, with all of the serious implications and consequences that this will have in terms of executive investment in education, health and economic initiatives, among others. And yet, despite the significant ramifications of this reclassification, there has been little to no detail of what plans the Communities Minister and Finance Minister had in place in preparation for this reclassification, which we knew in all likelihood was coming down the track, and nothing beyond headlines of what actions the ministers have actually taken since the reclassification was announced. In truth, this motion contains more detail than anything forthcoming to date from the executive or from either minister. In fact, the Minister for Communities and his counterpart in the Department for Finance clearly did not deem this issue important enough to come before this democratic chamber to make a statement on the matter, to give some reassurance to this House and to the people who elected us here, to give reassurance to each of the 22 housing associations affected, and most importantly, to give reassurance to the 37,000 people on the social housing waiting list and the 15,474 who are deemed homeless, who are desperately waiting and waiting for a home. Perhaps the Minister will share with us today the rationale for taking this approach. In fact, apart from a joint press release, which talked in vague terms of an approved executive paper seeking a non-detailed reversal of the ONS decision, including amending unspecified legislation and plans to seek a derogation, this House has been provided with no concrete detail of what both ministers are doing. The member for South Belfast referred to multiple statements from each minister. I don't know who those statements are. This leaves a number of questions that we are seeking answers to. What level of deregulation will be implemented? Will it have empowerment of the tenant at its core? What consultation has and will take place to ensure that Northern Ireland gets the right response? What discussions have both ministers had with their counterparts in Scotland and Wales to deliver a joined-up approach and ensure that Northern Ireland is not left behind? What is the minister's clear and detailed timeline for specific action? What amended legislation is being proposed? At what stage is this legislation? When will it be enacted? Will it be within the time frame that any Treasury derogation allows? If it falls outside of the derogation period granted, what safeguards will both ministers provide? And how advanced are derogation negotiations with the Treasury? Mr. Speaker, I have tried to obtain some of this information in a written Assembly question tabled on the 26th of September. But interestingly, the answer has been embargoed until today. Perhaps the Minister can explain why this embargo was put in place. But hopefully today, Mr. Speaker, the Minister will provide answers to these questions and others posed from members across this chamber, or at least follow them up in writing if it is not possible to provide definitive answers today. But before I conclude, Mr. Speaker, I would like to touch on another point. I firmly believe that with change comes great opportunity. We have here a very real opportunity not to freely deregulate, but to ensure that we deliver sensible, modernised regulation with the empowerment of the tenant at its core. Within this, there is also the opportunity, I would argue, to revisit the recommendation of the PricewaterhouseCoopers Strategic Review of the Northern Ireland Housing Executive, which was supported by the Housing Executive and supported widely right across the housing sector, to establish an independent regulator of social housing. Prior to this move to reclassify housing associations by the Office of National Statistics, good regulation and effective regulatory infrastructures has been a popular theme in policy development over the last two decades. We're often asked to look to Scotland for best practice, and so on this I would urge the Minister to look to Scotland for independence in terms of the regulator and to ensure that moving swiftly to address budgetary pressures, he does not store up a series of problems for the longer term.
Call Mrs. Naomi Long.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I welcome the opportunity to speak on today's motion and amendment. And obviously, as others have said, the context has now moved on because the expected decision of the Office of National Statistics has now been announced to reclassify the housing associations as public bodies. Mr. Speaker, you know that last week I raised as a point of order this matter, because I am of the belief that this announcement is so significant that it did require a ministerial statement before this House rather than simply a press release. Whilst the move was expected, its impact and the executive's response and preparedness to address it are matters of public and political importance, and ones that should have been brought to this chamber, not because, and it's all very well to criticise people for bringing motions to bring ministers to the House on this. Ministers could opt to come to the House of their own volition and give this information to raise
reassure the public. And so I welcome the opportunity that's been provided in this motion to seek that clarity, but I would like ministers to make the effort to do this of their own volition rather than deliver lectures to the rest of us about how we should go about doing our work. A highly significant change will not only have ramifications for important economic and social rights to housing, but will impact on the wider financial situation within executive departments. Housing associations have always been somewhat different from the Housing Executive in terms of how they have approached these matters. Until now, they have been able to operate as industrial and provident societies. That means that they could benefit from both government funding but also private finance to allow them to build more homes and perform essential upkeep of their current stock, should they so wish. It's commonly through commercial banks, Housing Finance Corporation, and more recently through the European Investment Bank. The Housing Executive currently provides around 90,000 homes, and housing associations make up around 40,000 properties. So all in all, we're talking about 100,000 individuals and families across Northern Ireland. It's also important to remember, Mr. Speaker, many of those are families who are vulnerable, facing hardship, and struggling to find employment. The ONS impacts on all of them in terms of access to funding for maintenance and upgrades available for their properties. In addition, it also impacts very directly on the 40,000 people currently on the housing waiting lists for suitable housing and who are in housing stress, as the ability to leverage private funds is crucial in allowing housing associations to develop new stock, and it is inconceivable that the executive could afford to make up the shortfall even in the interim without a serious negative impact on the plans and budgets of other departments. In June of this year, for example, the European Investment Bank gave £280 million towards social housing in Northern Ireland. That amount of money could not have been sourced if these rules had been in place. It was rightly welcomed at the time, but it is important if we are going to be able to get the construction of 4,700 new social homes over the next 5 years, alongside improvement of existing stock, that further opportunities like that are not now put at risk. And therefore, it's important that housing associations are clearly advised about certainty in their funding opportunities. The Minister himself briefed the committee and advised us that over the next 30 years, he reckons it will be about £6.5 billion will be required for the housing to be injected into housing over the next 30 years for accommodation to meet the significant demand on housing, both social and affordable. However, Mr. Speaker, without the additional leverage that we get from housing associations, that simply wouldn't be possible. In addition, the existing borrowing of housing associations has now essentially been converted into public borrowing, a move which has wide-ranging implications for the cost and access to borrowing for the executive. During his briefing with the committee, the Minister did indicate that the Department was alert to the possibility of reclassification and that Ministers were ready for the challenge, something which we welcome. When similar ONS rulings were made in regard to England, Scotland and Wales, Ministers had a case to present to the Treasury regarding emergency legislation to restructure housing associations in light of the judgment and to meet the requirements for them for their governance arrangements to allow them to be revisited in due course. This allowed a temporary derogation from Treasury to be offered. So can I ask the Minister whether such emergency legislation has been developed by his department and what the time frame for tabling that in the Assembly is going to be? What, if any, reassurance he has had from Treasury that such legislation as he has proposed and other proposals that he has developed will meet their requirements for a temporary derogation? Within what time frame would he expect such a derogation to be secured, and how long would he expect that derogation to last? And in respect of seeking a reversal of the ONS decision, what clarity can the Minister provide with respect to likely effectiveness of the measures proposed to meet those requirements? Mr. Speaker, I support today's motion and amendment, and I look forward to supporting the Ministers in what they do to ensure that these issues are adequately addressed.
Call Mr. Paul Garvin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I too stand to speak in support of the motions as put forward today, both the motion and the amendment. Albeit, I very much see this as people who are basically trying to make themselves seem relevant on a decision, putting forward a motion for something which the executive have already made a move on to deal with and address. No, I will not. I've only just started. And to be honest, the attitude is that the opposition are just jumping over issues, which actually we're wasting another hour and a half's time today discussing something which we've already dealt with. I'm not giving way, okay? Now, the point of the matter is that we have got members. There's Mr. Speaker.
I ask the members not to speak from sedentary positions.
Thank you. Chair. Mr. Speaker, I do support the motion in the way it's coming forward, and I think the executive have made a sensible decision in relation to asking for derogation in relation to this matter. And the ONS report that was submitted, and on the back of what they are bringing forward, it will create and would have created a major problem, both financially for this executive and the opportunity for further borrowing for capital projects that could be of great benefit. I do think that some of the housing associations are not without blame, because I will say that I don't believe they necessarily have delivered in the past historically. I don't think they've always been successful in delivering everything that was supposed to be done by them. But I think that there has been a certain amount of, and I'll not use the word culling, but I think a consolidation of housing associations in relation to a number of them have come together and have pooled the resource. And they are somewhat, appreciate we're talking about £1 billion of debt associated with these housing associations. There is a massive asset, and they are quite asset rich. So on the back of that, I do think that we have got to realise that housing executive as it currently stands is probably their days are numbered, and the difficulty that there is in relation to onward maintenance and delivery of that maintenance within the housing stock. But I too, representing the South Antrim area, know those people who come to my door, and quite a heavy load of the office work. I will indeed, yes.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. He's obviously very selective and wise in who he gives way to. The member will have heard from various sources a demand for more information in terms of the detail. The Office of National Statistics hasn't even published the detail of its ruling yet.
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you. I appreciate the member's intervention and for the information associated with the detail that we do not have within that report. But I did want to go into an area of the housing executive and how they're having some difficulty and, in fact, are wanting to engage in a transfer of assets to housing associations over the next number of years, where properties that are requiring investment and upgrade and improvement, because the housing executive say the mechanism is no longer there for them to actually to be able to fund that through the current process. So as a consequence, we have no alternative but to allow housing associations to do this. On the back of that, they do have the model. Yes.
Not accept that the inability of the housing executive to do those improvements was a political decision made by previous DUP ministers?
I think if you go back historically, it was long before the DUP took control of those departments that such a rule existed in relation to the funding mechanism which exists for the housing executive and how they have access to funding. So that is a rouge in putting that message forward. It's totally real. That does not tie in with any decision by a DUP minister. So as it stands, I'm now saying that the housing associations do have the mechanism to draw down the money to deliver the social housing in the areas that we do need. And I do appreciate and I do welcome the executive's intervention early, within hours of receiving the ONS report, dealing with this matter, and not waiting until they can just get a soundbite and try to make themselves seem relevant. And that is the area. And this is one of the areas where opposition is where you will be, and that's exactly where you should stay. Thank you.
Call Ms. Michelle Gildernew.
I welcome the opportunity to speak on this debate today, and other members have already pointed out that this motion is retrospectively debating an issue that has already happened, and that when the ONS acted to reclassify housing associations, the Ministers for Communities and the Minister for Finance brought a paper to the Executive immediately seeking that derogation. And the point has been made here already as well. The difficulty that we have is that there is a shortage in social housing, not just in Belfast or Derry, but right across the north. I am currently representing a wide range of applicants, from families to single men, to access a home in my constituency. The big issue is that there aren't enough units, there aren't enough homes, there isn't enough social housing, and the nub of the issue is that the body charged with the provision of housing, the Housing Executive, is no longer in a position to build new units, and my colleague Fran McCann has covered that, and I believe this is something that we will want to rectify during this mandate. I believe that until this situation is rectified, we'll still be playing catch-up. I'd also like to make the point that there are differences in opinion in how many units of social housing we need across the mandate. And I'd like to make the point today that we haven't taken into consideration that there are hundreds of adults living at home with aging parents who are currently there because there isn't enough supported housing or independent living for them. I'm talking about adults who are learned disabled or adults who have more complex needs, and we don't have adequate housing for them. As a result, there are aging parents who are deeply concerned about how their child is going to manage when they're no longer able to look after them. And I think we have to have a proper look at those figures and ensure that those people are dealt with when we are looking at the numbers of housing units that are needed. I think there has been a lively enough debate here today, I think there's still a fair high level of consensus around the chamber. And I think the SDLP amendment is something that we can support and will be seeking to do that. But the point I'd like to make is that that what is laid out in that amendment is work that is already happening. So we are talking about something that has happened, that is happening, and that the Minister... I've noticed that Mr Beggs has tried to interrupt a number of speakers. Maybe he should put his name down and make a speech himself rather than continually interrupting. But I mean, this is an important issue. Housing is at the very heart of what I got involved in politics for. And as Fra has said, World Mental Health Day, World Homelessness Day. These are two... A proper home... Somewhere, a roof over your head isn't a privilege, it's a right, it's a human right, and everybody should be able to enjoy that right. And I believe that we should do more to build more houses. I'll support the Minister in his endeavours to do that, but it is essential that we establish new housing units right across the north. This isn't just a Belfast problem. Gormila Magaf.
Call the Lord Mark.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. This is a debate, of course, that never needed to take place. And I think when we look at the opposition benches today, they now agree that it never should have took place either, because the co-signatories, the Ulster Unionists, can manage five, and the SDLP can manage one on the benches. So even they realise that this is a bit of a non-event, so it is. And I hear Ms Long continually fires from a sanitary position, but whenever she is up talking, she has not much to say, at least not worth... Look, hold on a moment. Hold on a moment. We've heard you parroting off all morning, and it must be very important what you want to say. Well, look, there's the speaker up there. Go ahead, I wouldn't get your name down. But for goodness sake, you're up and down there like a jack-in-the-box can give way. No, some of your colleagues will give way. They'll all be up in a few minutes telling a great story about a non-event. Mr. Speaker, it is unfortunate that the opposition on this occasion, and the first occasion that they decide that maybe there's something we could unite on here, and then they unite around nothing. And because what they are asking for to be done here is already being done. So therefore, and Mrs Long, I found it amazing, absolutely amazing. She said that the Minister should have been telling us all. Well, I suspect Mrs Long is not much different from me in this. She walks past the Minister's door maybe a dozen times a day. It wouldn't be hard for her to call in and say, could you tell me just about this? I am so anxious about this particular issue.
And so therefore, I think that, yes, well, come on. Oh,
the member for giving way. To be clear, it was not that I should personally be told. That is largely irrelevant. It is that the House should be told, as statements, for example, were made in the Chamber in Scotland, in Wales and in England when similar measures were taken.
It was a mistake to give way, but there's
The member has an extra minute.
Yeah, thank you. But can I say this? There's no one in this House, and in particular those of us who have served for some number of years on councils and elsewhere, and those of us who have served in this House, but we are very, very aware of the importance of social sector housing. We are also very aware of the waiting list that exists, and we also are waiting for some blue sky thinking from those who have seen to have all the answers, who seem to have all the answers on how to deal with a chronic waiting list here in Northern Ireland. It's not a simple one. And there's not one member in this House, not one going right round, who are anxious about this particular issue. And so those who have brought this motion today, they haven't done anything to push this issue forward. I suppose maybe what they're really doing is endorsing what the Executive and the Minister has already doing. So I suppose if there's something positive to take from it, we can take that. So therefore, yes, okay, come on.
The member will be aware that I posed a series of questions in respect of what both ministers and the executive were doing. Is the member in a position to be able to answer those? Is all of that information in the public domain?
Well, yes, I think from statements and that the minister has made, much of the information, if not all of it, is already available. And I would know you would be a good researcher and you could go and research all that information or get your staff to do it. Or I suspect the minister might, his department might be able to assist you if you contact them, and they'll send you out all the information you want. Because as one who has gone through that, I can tell you they have a very effective research department down there and they will assist you. And I don't say that belligerently to you. I say it in the tone that I hope it's coming across. But look, the opposition needs to realise if they would stop setting up straw men and knocking them down, then maybe we can get things done in this place. And there is, someone has said the amount of time that it takes legislation to go through, and yes, and I do know that, because as one who has pioneered a piece of private legislation in the past, I know how long it took, something like 3 years, for it to go from start to finish. So I don't underestimate the journey that a piece of legislation takes. But really, I do feel that they could have done a greater service by not pushing this sort of a motion here today on something that the executive has already applied themselves to, something that the minister is already working on, something that he has already pushed down the road, and something that he sees as important too. So therefore, if there's anything good that's come out of this debate today, it is just that the minister's decision that he has taken some time ago is being reinforced here today. And really what we are saying to you, Minister, you're doing the right thing, just get on with it. Thank you very much.
Call Mr. Roy Beggs.
Thank you. It's a rather sad event in a debating chamber when none of the government backbenchers are prepared to give way for debate. I'm lucky I had my name down here to get speaking, but I could have interacted and hopefully contributed to a discussion and debate with members had they allowed, but they obviously did not feel confident of themselves to do so. I rise to support the motion in the name of my colleague Andy Allen, Jenny Palmer and Philip Smith, and indeed the amendment in the name of colleagues and SDLP who have supported the amendment as well. I think it's important that this area is urgently addressed. And I'll go on to highlight why I have a degree of concern from past inactions, why it does need to be in the public domain and the pressure that there will be movement in this area, because there's concerns from the past. The decision of the Office of National Statistics to reclassify Northern Ireland Housing Associations should not have been a problem. A year ago, they did so in England. And what happened in England? Earlier this year, there was the Housing and Planning Act 2016, which in a section of it addressed the issues so that English housing associations could be reclassified back as private bodies. So nobody should be surprised with what has happened. What I am concerned about, given that knowledge, what costs will fall or executive or housing associations as a result of this reclassification? Is there going to be delays? I haven't heard when the new legislation will be coming forward as of yet. I hope the Minister will be able to address that when he gets to his feet later on. The other aspect of it, this is the Finance Minister has indicated that this will cost £100 million a year ongoing. Is there a charge in this year? And on top of that, of course, there's the issue, as my colleague Andy Allen has highlighted, of access to the financial transaction capital, which is also very important for housing associations, particularly in terms of the co-ownership scheme, which allows many people who might otherwise be homeless and needing social houses to find a home of their own. So we need to address this with a degree of urgency. Moving on then, just looking at the timeline, it was quickly addressed in England. And in Scotland, the First Minister has already said he will introduce a bill. Now, when I listen across the chamber here from government backbenches, I have confused. Are you all supporting the motion as amended? I picked up a degree of discontent. I also, yes, I will, unlike you and your colleagues, I will give way.
Well, I thought it would be an appropriate time just to indicate to the House, given that your amendment is doing exactly what I want to do and the Executive has already agreed, let me reassure you that I'll be supporting the amendment.
The issue is that
Member has an extra minute.
New legislation will be required, and that has not. That is very obvious when you see what had to happen in England, what has been planned elsewhere, and that has not been coming out very clearly in what has been said to date. To think that you can just ask for derogation, I think is living in cloud cuckoo land. It had to be amended in other parts of the UK, and it would therefore likely have to be amended here as well. The other area of concern, when I heard Mr McCann speaking, his solution was to give the powers back to the Northern Ireland Housing Executive. Can the Minister advise, when he gets onto his feet, would this solve our problem, or would that have additional costs still incurring, where we would not be able to build as many social houses? I would like to see clarity from the government benches, the DUP and Sinn Féin benches. Is that what the plan is? Are we going to simply put the ability to build houses back into the Housing Executive and suffer huge financial costs and being able to build fewer homes? So it would be helpful if the Minister would clarify that. The other area that I have a degree of concern about is from other aspects of our public sector in Northern Ireland. When researching this issue for this debate, I had a look in terms of the FE colleges, and there was a similar assessment in 2010 for FE colleges, which was applicable to Northern Ireland as well. In England, they brought the 2011 Education Act to address the issue so that they could remain their independence and be able to avoid costs and be included in public sector expenditure. My understanding is that is not the case in Northern Ireland. In Northern Ireland, our FE colleges still continue to be included, and that limits what they can do. It limits what Northern Ireland Assembly Executive can do with its limited borrowing. Bearing in mind, that's some 5 years ago. Now, what I do not want this issue to be still trundling on for 5 years. So if I've indicated, there's very obvious delay that have happened in the past, and I would seek reassurance from the Minister that we will not face similar delays in this issue. Because when we delay the ability to build new houses, disadvantaged members of our community do not get homes. Those in need, families in need, do not get a roof over their heads. So it's vital that there is not undue delays. It's also vital that we do not incur financial penalties as a result of indecision from our government.
Member
conclude and I would only hope that in future debate would be allowed in this House.
Call Mr. Stephen Farry.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Just to pick up from Mr. Beggs on the issue of further education, to say that there isn't any clamour within the FE sector for reclassification away from being a non-departmental public body. the situation in terms of further education in Northern Ireland is in a much healthier situation than in England, where there's been quite significant funding cuts, and they've been cut out from a lot of the narrative around the investment in skills and education. There was consideration given to a potential public consultation in relation to a reclassification or changing the governance around the FE to allow ONS to reclassify them away from NDPBs, but in light of our own difficulties around budgets and the fact that the executive put in place end-year flexibility, which allowed for surpluses to be transferred from one year to another, there is now a consensus that the status quo is the best way forward, so that it isn't an appropriate line to go down. I just want to make a number of brief comments around this particular situation. And I think the key issue of debate that's emerged in the chamber today is one around process. And somehow the opposition are out of order in bringing up something that the executive, in their infinite wisdom, are on top of. And almost building upon the theme of last week's business, we're seeing again the problems around openness and transparency in terms of what the executive's doing, and almost this privilege that we have in sometimes being told what the executive are actually up to. We should have open and transparent government where decisions are explained, questions are answered on time, and ministers are proactive in bringing information to the Assembly rather than putting the onus on everyone else to go around and find out the information. It's not just a matter for us receiving the information in terms of us as poor MLAs and the opposition parties. This is something that actually affects the public of Northern Ireland, who have an interest in hearing what has been said as well, and indeed in particular the housing associations and our wider policy objectives of being able to make sure that the resources available in Northern Ireland can be stretched to their maximum in terms of the outcome. And obviously the reclassification potential will severely curtail that in many respects. So I think a lot of this could have been avoided if the Minister had been proactive in bringing a statement to the Assembly, and that then in turn allows MLAs on behalf of their constituents to pose questions to the Minister. So I hope we can avoid this situation into the future. But nonetheless, this is an important issue, and it does go to the heart of the resources available to us and what we can do to make a difference. Yep.
Member not agree that it sounds a tad silly to stand to your feet and say it's the Minister's fault that you have brought a motion on the floor of the Assembly about an issue that the Minister has dealt with? It's his fault that that's happened?
It's not silly.
The member has an extra minute.
It's not silly in the slightest. I mean, it goes to the actual heart of this debate. There is, and there should be, a duty on ministers, and there is a duty in terms of the ministerial code, and they should follow through on that in terms of being open around these decisions. There is clearly a precedent in other jurisdictions where there are matters of major public interest that a minister is proactive in bringing that information forward and actually having scrutiny. Whenever I was a minister, I did it on a routine basis, as did others.
Yes. I thank the member for giving way. I mean, there seems to be much kind of kerfuffle in the corner because people dare to amend their motion. Would the member agree with me that that is largely to do with the timing of when the wording of motions actually have to be put down in the chamber, which is much far in advance of what would be expected in any other chamber in these islands?
And indeed, I mean, in concurring with my colleague, I can also recall many instances in which both the DUP and Sinn Féin, as the two parties of government, have done exactly the same thing with motions that have had to be tabled, where the circumstances have moved on since the original tabling of the motion. But it also shows that, indeed.
I thank the member for giving way. And the point that Naomi Long raises, no, Ms Long should get it into her head. It wasn't so much amending the motion. The motion should have been withdrawn altogether.
Well, I think for better or worse, this is the only opportunity that this Assembly has to discuss the issues. So if we had what should have been the process in this chamber of a ministerial statement, then we could have done this in a much more structured way, akin to what is happening in terms of Cardiff and Edinburgh, who actually have shown the way forward in this regard. And less that the current minister thinks we're picking on him. I mean, this is the current example, but this is a trend across the board. So he's not the only one who's fallen into the situation of not having the proper mechanisms of accountability. So today we're having the debate. We're able to raise the issues both of process and indeed of the substance. The final point I want to make is that there are issues in other parts of government where how the ONS and how we treat parts of the public sector do either allow or constrain the ability to borrow and to raise money. And I think I would encourage the executive to have a wider look across the piece in that regard. And in doing so, we may find, particularly in these very straitened economic times, that there are resources available to us without actually having to delve into and raise revenue directly from the hard-pressed householders across Northern Ireland, where we can
ask
make our
the
resources
to conclude
stretch
his
that
remarks.
Bit further in terms of investing in public services and our infrastructure. Thank you very much.
I call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Mr. Speaker, when I looked ahead to this debate, I anticipated quite a boring debate. I mean, this is a crucial issue that speaks to millions of pounds of public spending and potential having to rewrite budgets if we're not to get the derogation that has been talked about. So a vitally important issue, Mr. Speaker. But a fairly technical one, fairly dull issue, on which, as is clear from the fact that the executive parties are supporting a motion and amendment that has come from the official opposition, that there's a consensus on. So we're having a row about something we agree on. And I think what it speaks to is a government, an executive, that is in itself insecure by the idea of an opposition and debate. It's not unreasonable, Mr. Speaker, that we should seek to speak on something that, as I say, the impact of which would be over £100 million on our annual block grant.
Can I remind members not to be speaking from a sedentary position? The member needs to be heard.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This issue has not come to the Assembly floor except through oral questions which I have raised, one of which we ran out of time before it was even discussed. So, to the best of my knowledge, and apologies if others have raised questions, one response and supplementary from the Finance Minister is all we've had to debate, an issue that massively impacts on public spending. Today should be boring. It should be informative, but it's got caught up in heat, and that heat has been generated by an executive that seems to be playing opposition for opposition's sake. But to get to the issue...
Member accuses the executive of playing opposition for opposition's sake. Is he playing government for government's sake by supporting what the government's doing today?
I think
the member has an extra minute.
His question. The point is, how can we know what the government's doing if there's no statement made to the House? There's been, as Ms. Mullen has pointed out, there has been one public statement on the issue that lacked detail. This is a very complex issue. We're talking about deregulation of our housing associations. We're talking about a derogation from Treasury and negotiations for such. We're talking about an ONS reclassification. As I say, all very technical and should be all very boring, but we need detail, and that's why the debate's taking place today. I don't think that's unreasonable. Had there not been a motion, we'd have been told that we weren't on top of our brief, one of the biggest things that's happening within governance in Northern Ireland, and we're not even raising it. So I do think this is an executive playing opposition for opposition's sake. But to get to the issue, if we can take it as read, and I am yet to be completely assured that we're going to get our derogation and we will have a deregulation bill of the housing associations. And I would like to know about some of the specifics about that, because I think there's both fear and opportunity in this, and I think we should, what I would look for from the Minister is to allay the fears and to ask him to seize the opportunities. So can he outline in any legislation that may come forward to this House what impact it may have in strategic planning in terms of house building programmes and how much control we can realistically expect to retain in terms of stock levels? And if he could also give detail, as we seek a reversal of this decision and a derogation, what is the current status of public finances, and what discussions he's had with the Treasury on that point. I said there was opportunity because I think there is. One of the consequences of a deregulation of housing associations is that they would be brought out of the right to buy scheme, and I think that's something that I would welcome, and I would like the Minister's views on that. We currently have a significantly reduced social housing stock. If we go back to the 70s, we had 155,000 housing executive houses. We're now down to 88,000, plus I think it's 40,000 of the housing associations. That's not all down to right to buy, but it's been one aspect to it. And given the figures that have been outlined by others in the debate about distress on our housing waiting lists, I think that's one thing we should be looked at. But there's further opportunity, because as we look to the governance of our housing associations, we can look again at the governance of the housing executive. And I am one of those who would like to see an amendment of the rules to allow housing executive to build social homes again.
And ask the member to conclude his remarks. Those
capital investments. And my final point, Mr. Speaker, whilst Mr. Girvan pointed out it wasn't a DUP decision to change the rules about housing executive capital spend, every DUP minister
Member's
has upheld
time
that
is
decision.
Up. Call Mr. Jerry Carroll.
Speaker, and it is clear from the comments here, and when you look at the statistics, that we have a housing crisis, 43,000 people waiting on the housing waiting list, and this obviously includes our homeless, people with disabilities who need tailored accommodation, people who are being intimidated, or people who need to move elsewhere to be closer to families, or people who are stuck in hostels for years. And I think this issue, Mr. Speaker, in terms of the housing waiting lists in my own constituency and across the north, is fundamentally linked to class, economic class. Working class people don't have the ability just to have an extra few thousand pounds to purchase a house. Some who have been able to save over years are able to get a mortgage, and it's only through strict saving that they're able to do that. But this isn't, Mr. Speaker, an option for everyone. And public housing should exist as a right for everyone. And as has been mentioned, there are 87,107 housing units managed by the Housing Executive, almost double that that are managed by housing associations. But in this motion and the amendments subsequently, there's no mention of the Housing Executive. And I think it's essential that the Housing Executive needs to be mentioned in this debate. And for years, there's been calls to allow the Housing Executive to borrow. It's more than enough assets to borrow, Mr. Speaker. And I think it's something which needs to be addressed and seriously needs to be looked at. The Executive has continually lobbied Westminster for corporation tax to be lowered. And I want to ask, has the Executive once put pressure on the Treasury to allow the Housing Executive to borrow so that it can build? And I think one of the main issues in this motion mentions that housing associations should be allowed to borrow, and that this ONS reclassification will not allow them to borrow. And I think it's our view, Mr. Speaker, that housing associations should be public bodies, should be allowed to borrow, and housing needs to be the housing executive needs to address this, Mr. Speaker. So I think if we could take action to allow the housing executive to borrow, we could fund a crash course building for housing. I think we could alleviate and get rid of the issue of housing waiting lists and get rid of the housing crisis. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Bate, and the minister has 15 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to be able to address this motion in the Assembly today. Like other members of this Assembly, I'm fully aware of the work that housing associations do in building and maintaining a significant number of social homes in Northern Ireland, homes for many of the most vulnerable members of our society. I recognise again that anything that threatens that work and indeed the added value of the activities that housing associations undertake with and on behalf of their tenants is unwelcome and needs to be addressed. Let me reassure those members who brought forward this motion, the opposition, I'm not actually quite sure, Mr Deputy Speaker, if it was the opposition. I noted that when the motion was first brought forward, it was brought forward in the names of the Ulster Unionist Party alone. Then, having got it so badly wrong, I noted that the amendment was brought forward by members of the Ulster Unionist Party and members of the SDLP. I note that the Alliance Party weren't included in that, or the Green Party, or People Before Profit Party. Now, maybe the opposition only exists within the Ulster Unionist and the SDLP as official opposition, or if these other more minor opposition parties feel put out by that. Again, I'm not quite sure in terms of the genesis of this motion that was brought forward. A motion that, whenever I read it, was first laid, was wholly inaccurate in terms of what it actually was calling me to do. It called for the Minister for Communities to prepare to bring forward urgent legislation to reverse the classification of Northern Ireland housing associations so that they can remain classified as independent social businesses. Having brought forward the motion and the Executive being fully aware of all of these issues, and along with the Minister for Finance, I brought a joint paper through the Executive. We then had an amendment brought, and just that amendment actually demonstrates how flawed the first motion was by the Ulster Unionist Party, because that amendment, and maybe this was the expertise in the SDLP, or maybe it was the Ulster Unionists just reading the press release that I provided with the Minister for Finance, but the amendment now calls on the Minister for Communities and Minister of Finance to expedite the steps necessary to reverse this reclassification and to seek a derogation. No mention of the Minister for Finance in the original motion, no mention of a derogation in the original motion, but after the Executive takes a decision, provides that statement into the public, then we get an amendment which more accurately reflects what the Executive needs to do. However, the Executive is already doing it. Now, if this is the calibre in which the opposition is going to conduct its business, clearly it's going to be left to the Executive to get on with doing business, because the opposition should be able to highlight where the Executive does things wrong, how it should go about doing things. And whenever I listen to Mr Beggs, who said, asking for derogation only is living in cloud cuckoo land. That's exactly what we need to ask for, is a derogation to allow then the Executive and this Assembly the opportunity to take the legislation through it. Does Mr Beggs believe that we shouldn't have a derogation? Well, I don't know, because he's obviously not here in the chamber now. Maybe some of the members of the official opposition, led by the leader of the official opposition, wants to respond. Should we get a derogation or not? Mr Beggs didn't seem to know. I'd be happy to give way.
We just had question time with the Minister for Communities, during which he failed to answer two questions that I put to him. I wonder now that he's supposed to be answering this debate, might he do that?
I'm not sure that's a point of order, Minister Cohen.
It's not a point at all. So whenever I listen to the members who have spoken around this, and the SDLP, who were ably led by Ms Mallon on her own, I hasten to add, because the SDLP are so concerned about opposition, they just put one member down to front up the debate and nobody else joins them, a demonstration of how serious they actually take this issue. And they just so happen, actually, Mr Deputy Speaker, they just so happen to have the chairmanship of the committee. And the chairman of the committee, dealing with what is supposed to be, and rightly, is a very serious issue, wasn't able to be in here for the debate. Now, maybe the opposition need to reflect on the way in which they want to conduct their business, but this Executive is going to get on with doing business. And so when the Office for National Statistics announced their decision, within hours, this Executive has dealt with the issue, we've taken the strategic decision as to how we want to go forward, and the opposition are left playing catch-up, having to amend a motion that they originally brought to this House because they got it so badly wrong. So I want opposition to work. My party argued for opposition to be put in place as part of Fresh Start Agreement. It's because of that negotiation that there is an official opposition. Now, we're being badly let down in this House whenever we don't have people who are able to actually carry out the role of official opposition and be able to try and test this government, because they're not able to do that and make some progress, and then I'll happily give way to Ms Mallon. So let me explain a little bit more in the detail, and then I'll happily give way to Ms Mallon. In respect of the issue that was discussed, the ONS made its announcement on the 29th of September, the very day the decision was issued, and agreed that officials in my department should take forward as a matter of priority work to develop proposals to achieve a reversal of the ONS decision, and that officials in the Department of Finance should commence negotiations with Her Majesty's Treasury to agree a derogation from normal budgeting rules for a period of time to allow us time to progress the necessary legislative changes. On one level, this is a technical adjustment to do with the application of international statistical standards to national accounts, and if that was the extent of the impact, this would not be the important issue that it is. And this was highlighted by members, and this is why, as Mr Agnew rightly pointed out, this is a very, very serious issue, hugely serious issue, so issue the opposition should be ashamed in the cack-handed manner in which they have addressed it. So, whenever it's so serious, and members have outlined how serious it is, let me again repeat some of those points. The change of status means that the... I'll give way later to Mr Allen. The change of status means that the subsequent annual borrowing of housing associations will count against the department's capital budget. As a result, the capital needs of the housing associations would need to be assessed against other departmental priorities, and this is likely to constrain the annual borrowing of housing associations and therefore impact on the funding of new social housing development. In turn, this would result in a reduction of the number of new social homes being built each year, at a time when we've increased pressure on public finances and increasing numbers on the housing waiting lists, which is clearly an unacceptable situation. The treatment of the historic debt of the housing association needs to be considered as well, but that would have little impact in Northern Ireland. While the historic debt is added to the public sector net debt at a UK level, this does not impact on either the department's budget or the Northern Ireland executive's debt. Therefore, it does not affect the executive's borrowing powers. Officials in my department will now consider all the detail of the ONS announcement. They will also consider the response in the other jurisdictions in Scotland and Wales. They have just had their associations reclassified as well, and bring forward proposals which best suit our needs. The main areas that have been specified in the ONS decision include the powers of the department in relation to, and these are the following points, consent powers over the disposal of land, removing or suspending or appointing committee members to a housing association as a result of an inquiry into mismanagement, and directing housing associations to transfer land to another body as a result of an inquiry into mismanagement. I'd indicated it would give way to Ms Mallon and then Mr Allen.
Minister, on a number of occasions you've emphasised the grave severity of this issue, yet you spent the first 5 minutes, one-third of your response, deriding and scolding the opposition, followed by another 2 minutes telling us what we already know. Can you please address the substantive issues and address and answer some of the questions myself and other members posed?
Well, again, I'm not sure where members have been, but I went to the committee. I've highlighted to the committee that this was an emerging issue. I have raised it repeatedly during question time in respect of that this was an emerging issue that would have serious ramifications for our ability to provide the housing that we need to provide. So the travel of direction in all of this has been one where there's a decision coming, we're making preparation for it, and rightly the executive then engages on that issue, and within less than 24 hours of the decision being taken by ONS, the executive has agreed the strategic approach that we needed to take on it, and we now are moving ahead in addressing this issue. First step on that is obviously to seek a derogation. But I know the member during the debate said, where's the legislation? Why is there not legislation being provided? Again, for the opposition, in order for it to do its job, needs to know how actually all of these areas function. So excuse me if maybe the members feel that it's somewhat a bit of a lecture, but I'm doing it in the interests of trying to ensure that this opposition is in a position to actually do the job that it's meant to do. So whenever it comes to the ONS decision, The ONS has provided a summary in terms of this, and this is the official letter that was received on the 28th of September, made public on the 29th of September, which this executive then addressed. So the member wants to know, why is there not legislation on the floor of this assembly right now? Well, the member says she didn't ask it. Have a look at Hansard. But in respect of what this letter says, it's just the final paragraph in terms of what these issues are. And it says that this provides an adequate summary of the points most relevant to this decision. However, please note that this may not be an exhaustive list of all central government controls in place in current legislation. So the ONS is still to give the detailed publication of its report, which will identify all of these measures that they believe need to be addressed in order to have the reclassification. Now, what a foolish executive it would be to produce legislation not knowing exactly what it needs to legislate for. Now, that's a basic function of how the executive has to do its job. So whenever we get that detailed report, please be assured the executive has already taken these decisions and the issue is at hand, and the opposition can rest assured that we will be able to address them. Mr. Allen.
For giving way. The Minister emphasised on a number of occasions how serious this matter is. However, Minister, as other members have pointed out, it wasn't serious enough for you or the Finance Minister to come before this House and make a statement and give the House an outline as to how long of a derogation we needed to apply for in order to start shaping legislation. Minister, can you perhaps give us an idea of that?
Well, again, members clearly haven't been listening whenever we've been raising this issue, both at the committee and on the floor of the Assembly. This has been an issue that I've been questioned on, and I've sought to reassure members that I'm taking it very seriously. So seriously, in fact, within less than 24 hours of the decision being taken, the executive has taken the decision as to how we're going to effectively deal with it. And we immediately make that available to the public. Now, I understand that members of the opposition will feel that they're maybe not being taken by the hand in the way in which that they want to have their hand taken. But we've informed the public about all of this. That was released into the public domain. And instead of the opposition focusing on what the real issues are, what I hear from the opposition has been, in previous debates, they want the BBC Charter to have a requirement that it has to give coverage to opposition within this assembly. It's about where the opposition should be seated within this chamber. It's about the title that should be given to the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party. Opposition is a lot more about those issues. It's about delivering on the real issues that matter to people. And I happen to take this issue about the provision of social housing incredibly important, because we need to provide the homes that our people demand of us. And so we're going to get on with doing the business that's required of us to do. And over the next number of months, we will develop and consult on the proposals. It'll complete the drafting of the legislation, take that draft bill through the committee stage, and then bring it to this assembly. So I'll need the support of the committee in carrying out its scrutiny role whenever we get to that stage. And given that the issue members have indicated is so critically important to them, I have every confidence that that committee will expeditiously deal with all of that scrutiny, and we'll get this through in terms of receiving royal assent as soon as possible whenever we have the exact nature of what it is that we need to legislate. And I look forward to constructively working with all members on the issue.
Order. Thank you. I call Mr. Smith, Philip Smith, to wind the debate and the amendment. You have 10 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I rise to support the motion and the amendment and urge all members of the House to support it. As many have said during the debate, and I've listened to many of the comments we've had today, that if we had not brought this motion, when would this important issue have been debated? I, for one, certainly don't believe we're wasting our time today but bringing out key issues that need to be aired. When we as a party formed along with the SDLP, the official opposition, we said that we'd be constructive and positive opposition, and today I hope that we have shown that with the intent of both the motion and the amendment, which I believe can and should get the Executive Party support. That is why, Mr. Deputy Speaker, I've been surprised at the attitude and tone of some of the executive benches. It seems to be, how dare you ask a question, is the response. Well, I'm afraid we're going to continue asking questions, whether you like it or not, frankly.
Will the member go away?
Certainly I will.
Does Does not find it extraordinary that the Minister criticised the opposition for bringing this motion forward? However, he didn't find time within his 15 minutes to outline the timeline for derogation and when we will see legislation. Will that derogation be long enough to allow legislation to be brought forward, and what discussions he's had with the Treasury to ensure that that derogation is a timescale befitting of what we need to do here?
I thank Mr. Allen for his point, and I totally agree. I think the Minister spent 15 minutes saying very little. He did it very well, but he said very little. The one thing that this debate has brought out is a ministerial statement for what it was. It has delivered that output, a hugely serious issue, as the Minister himself admits. Otherwise, I think we were to do as maybe Mr. McCann expected earlier, which was to take that everything was all good, to be told the executive approved a paper last Thursday, and that we can all sleep easy. But I think the question for me was, why did the minister not proactively take this issue himself to the floor of the House? Where is the openness? Where is the transparency? Where is the respect for this House? At least Minister O'Muir tweeted yesterday that he was looking forward to this debate, referenced good partnership working, which is what I think everybody was trying to bring forward today. I presume his busy schedule didn't allow him to attend, despite his tweet, but at least he was making the right noises, I suppose. We have had to endure a patronising lecture from the Minister, and frankly, when he and his colleagues can deliver good government, I'll take a lecture on opposition from him. And until that time, he can frankly keep it to himself. But Mr. Speaker, I want to address the substance of the debate as well. While this is a statistical change to the presentation of national accounts, as my colleague Andy Allen outlined in the moving of his motion, there are critical elements to the ONS reclassification of Northern Ireland's housing associations to be public bodies. There's obviously the impact on the provision of public and affordable housing in Northern Ireland. And without the ability to access private funding, it will be impossible to achieve the executive target of 8,000 social housing starts. The Finance Minister has already made it clear that the only alternative under these changed accounting rules would be to fund future bills from the Northern Ireland budget, and frankly, that's totally untenable. It's also, in my mind, ironic that as this public sector voluntary exit scheme is coming to an end, we would be potentially adding 3,000 additional workers to the public sector payroll. So there are massive ramifications from this here, and I think something that needs to be aired, and this debate was both timely and required, despite what the Minister may think himself. So I think, Mr. Deputy Speaker, everyone has agreed that we have no alternative but to seek a derogation from the Treasury to allow us the space to bring forward legislation to deliver the changes needed to reverse the ONS decision. But what will the changes that will be needed? So, firstly, the Department's direction of governance will need to be changed, the consent before disposing of land, powers relating to the dissolution or winding up of an association, powers relating to the disposal proceeds funds will all need to be changed. Essentially, the reclassification is based on the degree of control the state can exercise over housing associations, corporate policy making, and legislation will be needed to reverse this ONS assessment. Northern Ireland's housing legislation is both older and more complex than Great Britain's, making our process more challenging. When the housing associations were classified in England in October 2015, Parliament was fortunate enough in that the Housing and Planning Act 2016 was already underway and could be amended to include a package of deregulatory measures. But even with this running start, the process is likely to take 18 months for royal assent. In this jurisdiction, we will have to start the legislative process from scratch, and I would encourage the Minister to get the process underway as time is against us. And it would have been useful today to at least have got some outline of what a timetable would need to be, and also an understanding of what the initial engagement has been with the Treasury around this derogation, because I believe the Treasury is being robust on this, and we will need to agree a window of at least 18 months to pass the required legislation. So the first action for the Ministers, both Communities and Finance, is to convince the Treasury that we have developed a tight timetable and a credible plan to reverse the situation, thereby deserving of their time and space to deliver the required changes.
Would the member give way?
I will indeed.
I thank the member for giving way. Would he agree with me that it's a shame that the minister couldn't provide reassurance that whilst we accept that the full nature of the ONS comments are not available, there is at least something that the executive can be working on in terms of legislation at this point based on the initial response of ONS?
I totally agree with the member, and it would have been nice to have heard some positivity at least from the minister rather than just the diatribe that we have had to endure. Mr. Deputy Speaker, it's been mentioned about the potential of a coordinated approach with colleagues in Scotland and Wales if required to secure the Treasury derogation for the three devolved institutions, and if that needs to be done, then so be it. We need to again progress that without delay. The legislative changes required will not drastically deregulate the housing association sector, so I do not believe that members should be overly concerned about the change needed. Housing associations will still be regulated by the department. They are still registered charities with charitable controls, and there are still the strong protections around the reinvestment capital grant of $2.3 billion that has been invested by the Northern Ireland Executive in housing association assets. In conclusion, Mr. Speaker, we need to see quick action from both relevant departments to drive forward the changes needed to reverse this ONS classification. Otherwise, our ability to borrow to invest will be stymied, and we will be unable to build the thousands of social and affordable homes that Northern Ireland desperately needs. I urge members to support both the motion and the amendment. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. The question is that the amendment standing on the marshal list be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it.